Good evening, friends. We'll just be starting in a couple of minutes. Hello friends, a very good afternoon to all of you who are joining us from India and around, and very good morning to all of you who are joining us from overseas. A very, very warm welcome once again to all of you, and I hope you and your loved ones are safe. Thank you for choosing to spend this afternoon or this morning with us at Renewsys. Today we have participants from across Europe, North and South America, Africa and Asia. And we're truly, truly humbled to have received over 1,000 registrations for this webinar. We have already crossed about 200 attendees who have logged in. And my sincere gratitude and thanks to all of you who have joined us today and who have been joining us at each of our webinars and encouraging us. For those of you who are joining us for the first time, I am Vinel and I lead marketing and communications here at Renewsys. We are the first integrated manufacturer of solar PV modules and its key components. So that is encapsulants and backsheets, which we manufacture at our factory in Bangalore, and solar PV cells and the modules itself that we manufacture at our Hyderabad facility. This is the sixth in the series of webinars that we're conducting. And just to tell you a little bit about this series, we began with the intention of making the most of this time that we have all sort of received unexpectedly, while we wanted to continue to reach out to the solar fraternity at large. And it is because of your support and enthusiasm that we've been able to continue for almost 6 weeks now. And we hope to go forward with, you know, more webinars. So please do share the topics that you would like us to cover. I've shared the link of our feedback form with you all. Just drop in a line of what topic you'd like us to address, and we'll consider how best to take that forward. Also, if you have any questions that you see through the webinar, I would request you to type it into the Q&A section, and we'll try and take on as many questions as possible. Last time we couldn't take a few questions because we had crossed 500 questions, and you know, many of them were overlapping, but we will try to cover as many questions as possible. We also have a blog that covers all these topics that we discuss at our webinars, but in a more simplified, quick read kind of format, which takes anything from a minute to 3 minutes to go through. So do drop by and take a look. And if you want to see recordings of our previous webinars, if you've missed them, then again, you can visit our website, www.renewsysworld.com/webinar. And we will continue to work hard towards putting up more content that could be of use. I will now be handing over to our presenters for today. We have with us Arjun, who leads the quality team at Renewsys. And joining him, we have Mayank, who's been a pillar at Renewsys and has several years of diverse solar experience. A very warm welcome, Arjun and Mayank.
Thank you. Thank you. And we all welcome the participants of the webinar.
I think we can begin, Arjun.
Good evening all, and good morning to our customers. Today in this webinar, we are going to cover unloading, unpacking, storage, cleaning, general information and safety. Coming to unloading, before unloading the modules or the packing boxes, you should check the packing list which is attached on the right hand side corner of the box, whether you received the correct product or not. All the details of wattage, module serial numbers, quantity of modules are clearly pasted on the packing list. From that, you will clearly understand how many modules you received and what is the watt peak and all other details. And we recommend unloading of modules from the truck using forklift or hydra. Always move the full pack with forklift. Don't move the packs before unpacking. Select the forklift according to your weight of the goods. That is, each packing box weighs around half a ton, and if it is in a stack, it is two pallets, which is weighing around 1 ton. We recommend to use 3-ton forklift to unload this packet from the truck. And we ensure that forklift sleeves should be 3 of the packing box, otherwise the packing box may tilt or drop. If the sleeves of your forklift is less, then you can extend the sleeves by extending the forklifts. The second unloading, we can unload using hydra, but always ensure that while unloading, use nylon sling. Do not use ropes to unload the boxes. If you use ropes to unload the boxes, the rope may damage your box and it may damage your modules as well. And ensure that the length of the sleeve should be uniformly distributed so that the center of gravity should be maintained, so box will not tilt. Box should be kept balanced. And once you unload the box from the truck, please place it on a flat surface. You should not keep the pallet on uneven surface. If you keep it on uneven surface, because of weight, the pallet may break. Coming to in continuation to the unloading with hydra, once you place on the boxes on the floor, please maintain a distance between two boxes should be greater than 30 centimeters. Please don't keep two boxes close to each other. If you place boxes close to each other while moving the boxes from that location to other location, it will be difficult. And do not ever stack more than two boxes on a pallet. If you're storing boxes outside, please use protective cover on the boxes in order to avoid damage from rain or sunlight. Unpacking. Unpacking of PV modules should always be done in a vertical manner, and always we recommend that two people should be there while unloading the boxes. And care should be taken while cutting the plastic strips. And the plastic strip should be cut with a proper knife. Right? Once you cut the outer packing strip, before cutting the inner packing strip, the modules should be held by 2 persons minimum, and the complete stack should be pushed towards the wall or a supporting wall, so that the modules will not fall down once you cut the inside packing strip. Storage. Once you unload, unpack, and you may store in the site or in your warehouse. Basically, we classified storage into 2 categories, temporary storage, long-term storage. If you're storing for temporary, always keep glass facing towards downside, that is on pallet side, and we recommend always modules should be kept on a pallet. On the pallet, we should keep minimum 3-play cotton cardboard. On that cardboard, the glass should be facing downwards, And the other module should also face the downwards. In that, you can stack modules on the palette. And we recommended we should not stack more than 26 modules on the palette. For long-term storing, you can unload the modules and you can keep on the palette sunny side facing the down, but you should be ensure that the pack is intact so that it will not get affected by rain or wind. And we recommend you should cover this palette, complete pallets, with a tarpaulin or a protective sheet. Please follow there's a set of instructions in our installation manual. Please follow set of instructions and do not pile more than two pallets on one stack. Coming to installation, modules should always fixed with two supporting membranes. It is not recommended to fix module on single membrane, and suitable hardware should be used. We recommend SS304 nuts and bolts and washer. The fixing mechanism should follow with nut, a washer and a nut.
Arjun, sorry, we just lost you for a little bit there. If you could just repeat that last bit.
Yes, sure. Are you able to see my screen?
No, we're not. Hello? Able to see. No, yes, now we can see.
Yes. I'll just repeat this slide again. Coming to installation, we should always install module on two membrane supports. And the module should fix to this membrane with M6 bolt, washer and a nut. And this all material should be SS304 so that we can protect this mounting mechanism from corrosion. And we should also recommend the module should not install in shadow, where the shadow is created by buildings or trees, partial shadow. No shadow is allowed on the module. We recommend modules should the distance between two modules should be 7 mm minimum. This will take care of thermal expansion of the frame. And we also recommend, generally our modules come with transparent film fixed on the frame. We should remove that frame before fixing the modules. If we don't fix and install the modules, the grounding of the module may not happen properly. There will be insulation. This transparent film is an insulation material, so we recommend to remove the plastic film and fix the module. We saw some site images where modules are placed one above the other, which is not recommended. If we place modules one above the other, the frames may get scratched and the glass may get scratched. Always module should be handled by two persons. Module should not be handled by a single person. And the connectors, while connecting the connectors, while making the series parallel connection of the modules, we should take care of these cables. Cables should be bent with at least 2D radius. That means if you are using 4 square mm cable, then the radius should be 8 mm. We should not bend cables. Second thing, when we installing modules on a tin roof, the connector should not leave on the roof. It should be fixed under the frame, or it should tied to the structure. It should not leave without. Why? Because the water may ingress or may ingress into the connector. We saw some other pictures from the sites. We saw the people are leaving some objects on the modules, which may create hotspot, and it will affect the generation as well. And we saw the people are sitting on the modules. It is not at all recommended. We should not sit on the modules. It may create some micro cracks. Coming to cleaning instructions, we recommend before cleaning of the modules, before cleaning of the modules, we should thoroughly check the modules, cables, connectors. Is there any loose connections? Is there any cable damage? And while cleaning, proper PPE should be used. If there is any cable joint or connector damage, it is recommended to insulate that cable before cleaning the modules. And the water used for cleaning, we should use RO water as the ideal option. If RO water is not available at the site, we can use tap water, but the hardness of the water should be less than 75 mg/L. And we prefer cleaning time of the module should be after 6. It should be after 6 and it should complete before 6. Basically, you should clean the modules at low irradiance conditions. And before cleaning, it is recommended to switch off your circuit breaker after the strings, that is in SCB, string combiner box, or AJB, array junction box. Water pressure should not exceed 35 millibar at nozzle level. And it is also recommended the water temperature should not be more than the module temperature. However, it can accept 20 degrees more temperature than the module temperature. If it exceeds more than 20 degrees, module may break because of temperature, because of thermal shock. So it is always recommended to clean modules at low irradiance or where there is low generation, or after it should start after 6 in the evening. If you find any stubborn marks on the module, you should soak that stubborn mark with water. Once you soak with the water, then you can rub the mark with sponge or brush. You should not use any sharp objects to clean any stubborn marks. No sharp objects are recommended to clean on glass. It may damage your ARC coating. And it is generally not recommended to clean backsheet of your modules. But however, if you find any dust on the backsheet, you can clean the backsheet, but make sure that you are not using any sharp edge objects, which it may damage your backsheet or it may damage your back surface. General instructions and safety. Do not damage or scratch the backsheet. If you damage or scratch the backsheet, there is a high risk of safety. You may get leakage current when you touch the module. So ensure that there should not be any scratch or damage to the backsheet. Do not clean glass with chemicals. If you use any chemicals to clean the glass, it will not only affect the ARC coating on the glass, but it may also affect the frame of the module. If there is any corrosive material in that chemical, it may affect the frame as well. So don't clean in glass with any chemicals, and work only on dry condition with dry tools and dry modules. When the modules are wet or when it is raining, you should not touch the module or you should not do anything with the module. Be sure that all the modules should be grounded completely. Do not stack more than one pallet. Maximum height you can stack two pallets, one above the other. And we saw in many sites, people are carrying modules with holding cables and the junction box. It is not at all recommended. And the junction box is strict to the backsheet with an RTV, room temperature valve line. And you should not hold the cables or the junction box while transporting the modules. Do not drop modules or allow any object to fall on modules. You may not see the physical breakage of the module, but you may see some EL cracks happening in the module if you drop some heavy object on the module. And you should not step on the module. Do not dismantle or modify any part of the module. You should not change the connectors, cables, or junction box or anything at the site. It is not at all recommended. It is a safety concern. And we also recommend, do not drill holes on the frame or the glass module. for our modules, we provide 8 mounting holes. You can choose any 4 mounting holes to mount the module. But if you have any specific mounting hole requirements, you can approach us. But on the site, it is not recommended to mount any new mounting holes. Do not treat backsheet or front glass of the module with paint or adhesive. If you treat any module surface with paint with adhesive, it may damage your ARC coating on the glass or it may damage your frame. We should not treat modules with adhesive or paint. And it's also recommended to not expose concentrated light on the module. If you expose a concentrated light on the module, you may get hot spot or even sometimes glass may break because of thermal shock. Do not change the vise or the bypass diode. And it is recommended do not disconnect the module under load. Once if you want to disconnect the module from the load, it is recommended to switch off your MCB at string combiner box level or AJB level. You should not disconnect module under load. And always module should be carried by 2 persons. And it is recommended to wear proper PPE while handling the module. And if module slips on the feet, it may damage your feet. Please wear proper. General information and safety. Do not leave module unsupported or unshipped prior to installation. We saw that many installers are keeping modules at the site, which after unpacking, they just store on the pallet and they don't keep as a bundle. It may, because of wind or other storm, the modules may fly over. Before fixing modules to the structure, be sure that modules are properly stacked and secured. And if you find any module damage at the receipt, please intimate to Renusys along with the photographs and supporting documents. This will help us to claim for insurance for transit damages. A module with broken glass or torn backsheet cannot be repaired at site or even at the factory. Broken glass can be sharp and it can injure if you handle it without appropriate production equipments. Thank you.
Thank you, Arjun.
Hello, Vida.
Friends, we are now open to question answers. So I'm just going to start by reading off a couple of questions, Arjun, that we've already received. One of the questions that we've received is dry cleaning recommended using a brush with soft bristles?
Yes, it is recommended. With soft bristle, you can clean the modules.
Okay, another question that we have is, we have several people who have installed systems on their homes and they clean it themselves. So they're asking us if, do you recommend or rather what normal household equipment do you think will help them clean the panels? Normal household cotton cloth, will that do?
Yes, normal, we call it as in Indian mopping stick. You can use the mopping stick, but it should be soft. You can clean that, but use the fresh water. Don't use any hard water to clean the modules. And it is recommended always clean modules after 6 in the night, and you should complete before 6 in the morning. And for households, I think you should switch off the inverter. If you're not having ACDB or DCDB at your location, you should switch off the inverter before cleaning the modules.
Okay, thanks. And is there like a minimum temperature that the water should be at, or like a maximum temperature? I think you've given us a range of 20 degrees, but is there like a minimum or a maximum temperature?
It's not like that. It's like we can clean it any water, but the water temperature and then the ambient temperature should be almost the same. That is advisable. You should not clean.
So basically, we should use normal water. Whatever
normal water. Yes.
Room temperature is.
Yes.
So okay. I would like to add that in somewhere in the foreign countries, if it is too cold, the temperature of the water and the ambient should be less than 10 to 15 degrees. So it's applicable for cold regions also.
Okay. Okay. And we have a question from Amit. He asks, what is the allowable TDC level for water?
Sorry, what level?
TDC.
I think it is TDS.
Okay, probably he has. Okay, so yeah, maybe it is TDS.
Yes, yes. The hardness of the water should not be more than 75 milligrams per liter.
Okay.
If it is more than that, you may see some scalings on the module.
Okay. And what is the proposed torque level to tighten M6 nuts and bolts?
It depends on what bolt and nut they are using. I think we can get from the it depends on the material what they are using and nuts and bolts. We can get it from Google and we can reply them offline for all the categories.
Okay, great. And if they have a tracking system, then is a single support fine for a single stack?
Yes. But before we recommend, you should go for STAD analysis before taking the call. Yes, we recommend one supporting membrane is enough, but then most of the trackers use their extended bars to hold the module. But okay. Before that, we should go for STAD analysis.
Okay, thanks. Another question that we have is regarding panel maintenance again. What if someone wants to use anti-dust coating that is available in the market? Would you recommend it or dissuade?
See, we came across many products in the market, but we saw there's a corrosive materials in that solutions. It will not only damage your ASC coating, but it may damage also your frame. But if you have any special chemical which is available in the market, you can please write to us. We will show check what will be the effect on the module and we'll recommend on that.
Okay. And if you could just quickly take us through the wet cleaning bit again. We have a couple of requests for that. The wet cleaning slide when people want to clean with water.
I think it's slide number 15.
Yes.
Okay. Wet cleaning. See when you see a stubborn marks like burr drop or a dust which is got accumulated on the module for long duration, it is difficult to remove with mop stick or with a water. So we recommend you should soak that. You should soak that dirt mark with water or water jet before cleaning with the brush or the sponge. And once you clean that, you can rinse with the water so that the mark will go off. And it is also recommended not to clean your backsheet. Cleaning of backsheet often is not recommended. But if you see any dust marks on the backsheet, you can always clean the backsheet, but you should ensure that you should not use any sharp objects to clean the backsheet.
Okay, thanks. So in follow-up to that, we have a question from Senthil Rajakumar. He's asking, is it 35 bar or 35 millibar? What is the water pressure supposed to be?
35 bar.
Okay, thanks. We have another question from Sharda, who's asking if there are any views or what is our opinion rather as Renewsys on the use of a sprinkler system.
Yes, nowadays people are using sprinkler system. Yes, we can use sprinkler systems, but we recommend that before using sprinkler system, the module tilt angle should be maintained. If you install modules at 5 degrees or less than 10 degrees, the water may stagnate on the module if you use sprinkler system.
Okay.
So it is not recommended the module, water should not stagnate on the module. It should come off.
Okay, it should flow off. All right.
Yes, flow off, yes.
We have another question from Abhimanyu. He is asking about smaller sites and crowded areas where it's not possible to use a forklift. What do we recommend? How should people handle the pallet at such a place?
Generally, we recommend to unload with forklift, but if there is no way we cannot unload with forklift, then minimum you should use 4 to 6 people to unload one box. It is recommended to remove panels at the box itself and move one panel after the other panel from the truck.
Okay, thanks. Another couple of questions related to cleaning. So you mentioned right at the start that before cleaning, people should inspect the panels, and if there's any damage, that needs to be taken care of before cleaning can be undertaken. So we have a question from Gaurav about what happens if the glass is cracked? How quickly should people replace it? And is there any way for them to find out other than going and physically inspecting if the glass is cracked?
Without physical inspection, it is difficult unless you see some generation drop on your remote monitoring system. But once you notice the glass got broken, immediately you need to replace the module. Why? Because there's a safety concern. If someone cleaned the module without noticing that the glass has broken, you may get shock, even the cleaning at low irradiance, or even the glass may injure the person who is cleaning the modules.
Okay,
and
yes,
definitely, for sure you will get less energy generation once the glass got broken, and you cannot repair at the site or even in the factory.
It has to be replaced.
It has to be replaced. We cannot change the glass for the module.
Noted. Another question we have from Rahul here on how to deal with scaling. What is the kind of process or procedure that they should follow if scaling is already observed on modules?
Well, this is frequent question. See, scaling in the market right now, there are few chemicals which are available for cleaning for scaling. But we saw most of the chemicals are using some corrosive material in that chemicals. It may damage your ASC coating or the frame. So we don't recommend any chemicals. But however, you can clean this scaling marks with a detergent or a soap water. But it will not go in one wash. You should wash repeatedly. You can see some improvement. But 100% removing of scaling is not possible.
Okay.
Yes, Vinay.
The next question that we have is in case of residential rooftop systems, where there is not possible, I think, for them to install a scaffolding or something, do we have any suggestions on how many people should be handling the panel when they have to install it? A regular standard size panel?
Two persons. It is always recommended the module should be held by 2 persons. When we are talking about 72X module, 2 persons. When we are talking about 36 cell module, like 50 watt, 100 watt, yes, 1 person can handle. But if the module size is more than 1 meter, 2 persons should handle the module.
Okay, thanks. The next question is from Rati Solar Indoor. Is it recommended to ground each panel with grounding holes, even if it has a continuity with the structure that is grounded?
Yes, It is recommended to ground each and every module. The structure in India especially, we use a structure with anodized coating. Once it is anodized, it is not proper conductor. It is not good conductor. So we should always loop the modules with the earthing wire to all the modules. At the last module of the string, we should ground it. And the structure also is, now people are doing anodization for galvanization for the structure. And once we galvanize the MS structure, it is not a proper conductor. So we should ground the module. All the modules should be ground in a loop manner.
Okay, thanks. Another question that quite a few people are asking us is, how do they determine what is the frequency of cleaning in their area? Some of them are writing to us from the Middle East, where there is a lot of dust because of the dry weather. Others are writing to us from places where it rains quite frequently. So all of them have a similar question. How should they know how often they should be undertaking cleaning?
See, this cleaning, we call it as soiling. We can only check whether... Binal, am I audible?
Yes, please go ahead.
Yes, cleaning we call it as soiling. This can only, we can set the frequency of cleaning modules by seeing your generation data. If you see any generation data drop, that means high chances that module are got dust accumulated, so we should clean. And one more thing, when you monitoring with remote monitoring system, if you see your PR ratio is going above 90, that means your pyranometer got dust accumulated. That's why your PR is going high. That's an indication that module got dust accumulated.
Okay.
Vinil, I think.
We have another question about the deposition of carbon particles or again different kinds of non-water soluble stubborn stains. How should people address those? Should they write to us for information? What should they do basically?
Yes, better. I think if you write us, we can see what will be the impact on ARC coating and the frame or the back sheet. But if you see it is mild effect of carbons, you can clean with detergent or the soap water.
Okay, thanks. We have another question here. If you could just take us to the very first slide about unpacking panels from boxes, and could just quickly walk us through those steps again. Yes. The first couple of slides, yes.
See, we have two types of packing. One is full packing, one more is two-part packing. If you got modules in full packing, then you can cut the outer strip using a knife, and the modules will be in the box, so you need not to worry. You can remove one module after the other module if it is a full packing. If you receive material in two-part packing, then you should cut the outer strip, outer plastic strip with a knife, and you should open the cover, and there will be one more strip inside the box. There will be three more strips inside the box. Before cutting the three strips, 2% should hold the modules, and should slightly bend towards the support. Whether it is right or left, they should support all this module stack to wall, and then cut the three strips so that the center of gravity will be towards the wall side. Module will not fall on your feet or it will not drop. That is the unpacking procedure for the module. Once you unpack or remove the module, you should place it on a pallet, and the pallet, you should not place module directly on the pallet. You should keep triple sheet, that's packing cover, box cover, what you receive, you can keep that cover on the pallet and place sunny side down, that is glass side down, above that module again sunny side down, and so on. Then you can stack only 26 or 29 as you received in the packing box. You cannot store more than that.
Okay, thanks Arjun. Another question we have from Dhruv is which fitting arrangements are better, J bolt, mid clamp or ed clamp?
See, good question. See, we recommend you can use either one, it's not a problem, but it depends on the location of the site. Better before going for the confirmation, it is recommended to do STAD analysis with the J bolt with the stretcher mechanism, and then you can take a call. But it depends on the local area where there's bin speed, what is the bin speed, whether it is coastal area. It depends on that parameter, but for our module, you can use anything, provided it STAD pass the test.
Okay. And what about bifacial modules? Can you tell us a little bit about cleaning bifacial glass backsheet panels?
Yes, cleaning bifacial is tricky compared to monofacial, like glass to backsheet, glass to normal backsheet modules. We saw there's still studies going on. We saw that if you clean glass side, suppose say once in 2 days, backside doesn't require that often frequent cleaning. Even though we are getting energy generation from the back, the dust will not accumulate back as like on the front side, and dust will drop from the backsheet. But you can clean with a mop or a soft cloth on the backside of the backsheet for bifacial modules. But it's not so recommended, like the front side we are cleaning once in 2 days, backside we should also clean once in 2 days. It's not like that. You can clean like once in a week. If you're cleaning once in 2 days on front side, once in a week you can clean the backside for bifacial modules.
Okay. And is that the same for glass bifacial modules?
Yes, the same.
Okay. Then we have a question from Aditya. When there is a tin shed roof, what should be the minimum clearance between the module and the tin surface?
We recommend we should keep minimum 100 mm. 100 mm should be the clearance. Why we recommend that is, if you go closer to the tin shed, the module temperature will increase, the air circulation will come down. If module temperature increase, you will see some generation drop. So we recommend always minimum 100 mm should be maintained from the tin roof to the lower edge of the module. And it is also important that maintaining the O&M of the modules. If you go closer to the tin roof, then if you notice any damage on the cables or connectors, it is very difficult to do rework or see what is happening under the module.
Okay. Thanks. So we have another question from Prashant Singh. He's asking that they have actually gone ahead and installed panels on a rooftop near an industrial food grade chimney, and they're having trouble with oil condensation over the modules. So he's asking two things. I think one, how frequently they should be cleaned, and second, what is the best way to get rid of that oil for the first time?
First, answering to the first question, if there is chimney and it's getting oil accumulated, we require every day they should clean the modules. First thing, it will stick to the backsheet as well. If there is some oil deposition, it will stick to the backsheet as well. And this marks, it is very difficult to peel off or to remove that marks. You should only use a detergent or a soap water to clean that modules. But sure, it will not go in one wash. You should wash for say 15 days, 20 days, then you will see some improvement.
Okay, but most of it you're saying with regular washing will be under control.
Yes.
Okay, great. Another question that we have from Sandesh from DR Velar Engineering, he's a consultant. He asks, what is more like what is preferred, cleaning with water or cleaning with a soft dry cloth?
Cleaning with dry soft cloth is recommended, but if you see dust accumulated more, then we prefer clean with water. Suppose if you're cleaning with dry cloth once in 2 days, at least once in a month you can go with cleaning with water. But again, you should continuously monitor the energy generation from the plant. If you see any drop in the plant, or if you see when after your cleaning the generation has improved, then you should keep close eye on that, and according to that you should plan your cleaning frequency.
Okay, noted. Another question we have is related to welding now. Is it possible to do welding work on the structure where solar panels are already installed?
No, it is not at all recommended to do welding work once the modules are fixed onto the structure. That sparks may damage your backsheet, and once if it damages the backsheet, if you notice it is good. If you don't notice the damage on the backsheet, your inverter will trip because of leakage currents, and there is a safety hazard. So it is not recommended to weld at the site once the modules are fixed onto the structure.
Okay, thanks. So we have a question from Sanjeev. He's probably based in an area where he doesn't have access to RO water or tap water, which is less than 75 milligrams per liter TDS. So he's asking, is it possible to alternate cleaning with hard water and normal water?
No, it is not recommended. If you clean with hard water, the scaling will start appearing on the modules. Once the modules are got scaled, it is very difficult to remove that scaling. For now in the market, unless there is some new technology coming up, for now it is very difficult to clean scaling on the modules. It is recommended you can install small softener at the site, and once it is softened, you can use that water to clean the modules.
Okay, thanks. Another question that we have is about the gap between the modules. Is it okay to use adhesives to close the minimum gap between solar panels?
That we are still studying. We are not sure what will be the impact, but we saw there will be some thermal expansion of the modules. That's why we recommend 7 mm as a gap between the modules. But if the people are using for carports and all, they're covering with RTVs or sealant the gap between the modules. We don't know what exactly happens there, but we are studying on that. We'll get back to you on that.
Okay, thanks. What about using an air blower? Will that be recommended if it's just dust, an area with a lot of dust?
Yes. You can clean with air blower. Nothing harm on that. But you should see the pressure. What pressure it is blowing the air?
Okay, so same.
Of course, our module.
What is the recommended pressure if it's an air blower?
Pressure we can go with 35 bar. Less than 35 bar.
Okay.
Yes, for
our
modules are certified with 2400 pascals of wind speed on both front and back, and 5400 pascals of wind snow load on front. So it is recommended to clean with air blow. There's nothing harm in doing that.
Okay. Vikram is asking us what he should do if the panels have started to get yellow stains.
Inside the module, what you want to say?
On the surface.
I think the glass will not change into yellow unless there is some deposition, some material deposition or something. If you see the yellowing of panels, that may be because of EVA. discolorization or backsheet discolorization. You should closely look on your generation data. If you see there is a generation data drop, then you should intimate to your manufacturer. But okay. Basically, the yellowing happens because of EVA or backsheet.
So you're saying it may most probably be an internal yellowing. You'll have to take note of that first.
Yes, and you can only see in between the gaps between the cell to cell and gap between the cell to frame. You cannot see everywhere the yellowing. You can see only in this portion. If you see in that portion, that means the EVA has changed its color or the backsheet got degraded.
Okay. Will there be a change in these pressure measurements that we have if the type of module changes, like if it moves from a standard glass backsheet panel like we are discussing, or two panels that Renusys doesn't manufacture but are out there like thin film, etc.?
No, it depends on the thickness of your glass. If the thickness of the glass is 3.2 mm minimum, then this pressure is recommended. If you're using lesser thickness of glass, then you should look at the pressure values from your manufacturer. But Renusys use only 3.2 mm glass.
Okay, thanks. Another question that we have is about angle of installation. So this customer is asking if we install modules at a high angle above 23 degrees versus a low angle of 17 degrees, will there be a significant difference in output?
Well, it depends which part of the world you are installing. If you're close to equator, yes, it will impact more. If you're far from the equator, the impact will be less compared to close to equator. But you can run this simulation in a PUC software where it will give you an energy difference. What will be the energy difference with different angles? From that, you can know what will be the energy drop.
Okay, great. And we have another question here about the rainy season. Do people have to do anything during the rains, or you know, the panels will self-clean themselves?
Nothing. People should not do anything during raining. It will self-clean the panels. That is right. But if the installation of your modules happen less than 10 degrees, say typically 5 degrees or 6 degrees, you should check whether there is a water stagnate on the module. If water is stagnate on the module, then sure you need to wipe it off. Water, you should remove the water basically.
Okay, not allow it to accumulate.
Accumulate water on the module.
Okay.
See, one thing, Vinay, see here, the module, the four sides of the module, four corners are the weak spots of the module. While even unloading or loading or even installing, we should take care of these four corners. If something hits on any corner, module will break very easily. Even though we step on the module, on the center of the module, it may not break. But if you hit, a slight pressure is applied on the corner of the module, it will break. In the same way, when we are installing on tin roof or this roof, when the water got accumulated on that, there is a high chances that moisture may ingress into the module. So we should remove the water from the module.
Okay. Another question that we have from Rupa is for large scale plants, starting the cleaning process after 6 is a little difficult. So they're asking if is there something else that they can do to manage cleaning the plant maybe a little earlier or after 6 in the morning. What do you think?
Yes, these days people are coming with robotic solutions to clean the modules, but it is not like matured for cleaning of modules. If it is very large, yes, people can go for robotics, but before going for that, you need to get it approved by robot manufacturers, how it will impact cleaning of modules, as well as you should get approved from the module supplier, module manufacturer. And yes, it is recommended always to clean module after 6, and you should complete cleaning before 6. If you clean before that, you may see some energy generation drop because of cleaning, first thing. And the second thing, it is also a safety hazard. While you're cleaning, if there is some rat bite to the cables or something at the site, it may give a shock to the person who is cleaning the modules. So it is not recommended to clean modules during daytime.
Okay. And what about module orientation? Does it make a difference whether modules are portrait, installed, or landscape in terms of generation overall?
No, nothing. Nothing. It will impact the generation. We can install portrait or landscape. It doesn't matter. Only you should check the cabling part. You should check the cabling part from the JB. That's it.
Okay. So, what is the kind of gain people can expect if they're frequently cleaning their panels? Can you help us understand?
Yes. Many studies says that you'll get, especially in India where there is huge industries and carbon deposits are more on the module, they see around a 3% gain. And it will be around a 2 to 3% gain in generation if you clean modules frequently.
Okay. We have a question from Akshay. He's asking, what is the best way to lift panels to a great height, especially when installations are being done on top of high-rise buildings these days?
We suggest that a complete pallet box with module should carry to the top stairs, high-rise buildings. There you should unpack the modules and you should start installing modules there. Then, instead of carrying one module, one after the other module to the high-rise buildings, carry complete box to the high stairs with these cranes and hydras, I think. That is the easiest way to do that.
Okay, and we have a question here about grounding. Can we use a serrated washer for module to module grounding?
Yes. That means, if my understanding is right, is instead of using a cable loop, you will use a washer between the two modules to join two modules grounding. If that my understanding is right, yes, they can use washer to connect two modules grounding together.
Okay, I'm just going through a few questions. If you can just explain in the meanwhile to our friend Pankaj, what is the kind of clearance that they should maintain when installing modules on rooftop, depending on the roof types? Different roof types, is there a different clearance that they should be looking at?
Yes, from roof to the module edge, we recommend we should maintain minimum 100 mm, and module to module you should maintain 7 mm. Why we are saying 100 mm? This because if you install module close to the roof, you may see some energy generation drop because module may get heated up, and module is negative temperature quotient. When the temperature goes high, the power generation will come down, first thing. And the second thing, the distance between two modules should be minimum 7 mm, because the module may expand, the frame may expand when the temperatures are high. So it is recommended to maintain minimum 7 mm between module to module.
Okay. Divya is asking us if there is any product available to remove scratches from the glass of a module. And another question that we have also received is, why does generation drop if there is a scratch on the module glass.
Yes. One second. Yes, if there is a scratch on the glass, generation may come down because of light reflection. If it is smooth and if it is some scratches are there on the glass, the light may scatter. Instead of going inside the module, light may scatter from the outside surface of the glass and you may see some generation loss, but that impact will not be much. But if you see some deep scratches on the glass, you are indirectly you are weakening your glass. The glass is not strong to take load from the external wind load or the snow load. If you have deep scratches, yes, the glass will be weak compared to glass without having any scratches. First thing, and second thing is generation. Yes, it will be impact on generation, but it will be very less because of light scattering from the glass.
Okay. Laksh Sola from Gujarat are asking us, if a panel is damaged, how quickly should it be replaced, and what is the impact on the output of the entire string in the meanwhile?
Suppose you're having in a string, you're connected 5 kilowatt of modules, and one module got damaged, or one module got broken glass, then you are losing that complete string energy, that complete string generation, not to 100%, but you will see around a drop of 20 to 30% energy drop in that string. That will be the impact. And once you identify the, if you see any glass broken, you should immediately replace the module with good module. Why? Because it's not only the energy generation drop, but also it is a safety hazard. Like if some person touched the module after the glass broken, he may get electric shock. That's the reason you should immediately replace the glass, ensure energy generation will be there. And if in a string 5 kilowatt modules are connected, you may see around 20% drop in that energy generation.
Okay.
But that module still produce some energy. It's not like it will go completely zero. It will produce some energy.
But it will continue to be a safety hazard also.
Safety hazard, and at the same time, see, other modules are producing, suppose say 9 amps, and the module which is broken will produce around 6 amps, suppose, if it's producing 6 amps. So the complete string will drop to 6 amps. So okay. Indirectly we are lowering the other module efficiency also to this broken module. So we get energy generation loss.
Another question is about modules that are installed in coastal areas, and I think we can take this especially from the perspective of Renusys panels. Is there any damage that happens because these panels are installed close to a coastal area or a city near the sea like Bombay, and is there any special way to maintain these panels?
Nothing, it's normal cleaning is surface the purpose. And our panels, Renusys panels, are certified with salt mist test, with 6 times the salt mist test, like 6 cycles, which is very harsh condition of coastal area. Our modules can take that. Only thing is they need to clean frequently. That is sufficient for them to keep modules up and running.
Okay, for large module installations, especially around industries of various kinds, whether it is cement or paint, where the residue that gets deposited on these panels are more stubborn than general dust, is there a specific ONM procedure that installers should follow or a checklist that they should follow to ensure that the plant keeps working to its optimum capacity? Mayank, you want to take that?
Just repeat the question, please.
Yes, so the question is basically in the cases of large-scale installations, which are close to industrial areas and factories, where there is a deposition of residue from, say, a cement plant, a paint plant, etc., or like we discussed earlier, from an oil manufacturing plant. In such cases, is there a specific O&M procedure that installers should follow, or is there a specific cleaning cycle that they should follow that can help them, you know, increase the life of the panels also and get maximum output as well?
So, since it is under adverse conditions of atmosphere, as you have, as they have said, it is around cement plant and oils are there. Yes, it should not be treated as a similar cleaning technique, and more precautions have to be taken so that the generation is good and the life cycle of the module is maintained. We would prefer to take further details from the customer and respond it individually by email.
Okay. Another question that we have is from a gentleman called Harshal, who is asking what happens in a really worst case scenario if they're not able to manage and they have to end up climbing on the panel while installing it, especially in the case of mid-clamp fitting. I know we've been saying that they're not supposed to climb on the panel, but is there any other advice or feedback that you can give them?
Vinayal, I mean, again, I think something.
Yes, yes, Arjun.
Something went wrong.
So yes. The question is from one of our attendees today, who says, what happens if we've been saying since the start, people should not be leaning on the panel, should not climb on the panel. But what if for some reason, like mid-clamp fitting, they have no option but to sit or stand on the panel? We have been saying it's not advisable, but is there any other solution that we can provide to them? An alternative of how they can do it, perhaps?
No, there is no other alternative, if you ask me. There's no other alternative. We should not step on the module. If you step on the module, it will incur with micro cracks, which we can't see with our naked eye, but still the cell is broken inside. And over a period of time, you can see other defects in the module if you step now. That's why the mid-clamping system is not so popular. It's not getting popular in these days for installation. People are shifting towards other mechanism for installation. I think you should look for the other option to install the modules instead of going for this clamping time.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Arjun. Vinayak from Fourth Partners asking us, what is the difference in the yield of the solar panels if they have been dry cleaned versus wet cleaned?
Well, there are some studies, some research papers on this, and people see it depends on the region where we are working on that. But for India, we don't see really much impact, dry cleaning versus wet cleaning. It's always like it's the difference is less than 1%, which may be error, even error also. There is no difference, if you ask me. Many research papers are saying that.
Okay. Kishore is asking us if we have any recommendations for lightning protection of PV modules installed in field.
Yes, for sure. We need to install lightning arrester, and it is recommended always to install lightning arrester at north side of the plant. so that the lightning arrestor doesn't create any shadow on the modules. And you can use, it depends on the plant size, you can go with conventional lightning arrestor or anesthetized lightning arrestor. It depends on the plant size. But for sure, you should install the lightning arrestor for solar modules.
Okay. Nilesh is asking us, what are the reasons for glass breaking other than impact of something hitting it?
Well, there are many, many reasons for glass getting break. First thing, it may be happening during cleaning. If the temperature is different, is more than 20 degrees than the ambient temperature. If the water temperature is more than ambient temperature, say 20 degrees, or the module temperature is more than 20 degrees than the ambient water temperature, the glass, due to thermal shock, it may break, first thing. And the second thing, it may be because of hot spot. If there is a cell with higher temperatures and the other cells are operating at less temperature, we call it as hot spot. If there is a hot spot, you will see this glass breakage. And you can, if it is because of hot spot, you can see for sure the backsheet melt may have, backsheet may burn, or you can see the cell may burn. There is a burn. You can see the burning marks on the cell or the backsheet. Because of that thermal shock, glass may break. The two reasons basically.
Thanks. Praveen is asking us, if they want to use solar panels as a car parking shade, what should they be using between the panels to sort of make it waterproof?
Yes, instead of using sealant, there will be there are some gaskets, we call it as. I don't know if you understand the gasket, but they call a gasket a rubber liner, which they can place on the module to fill that gap. A liner which made up of rubber, which is UV resistant and all that. They fix that, fill the gap with that rubber rail, so that the water will not come down or water will not penetrate downside.
Thanks. I'm just quickly going through to see if we have any other questions that we have not covered. For those of our friends who are asking about PID and hotspots, we've also conducted two webinars in the past on those specific topics. So do drop by our website and you all can have a look at those webinars. In fact, you would be able to watch the entire webinar, including the Q&A section. So please do have a look. For those of you who are asking about different materials for cleaning, I would say it is best if you are thinking of using a certain item to clean the panels, to write to Renusys directly through your sales contact, and we will take a look at that material and its composition and get back to you. But we of course strongly recommend not to use anything without checking with us, and definitely not use any acid or sharp objects or rough bristles that some of you all are asking us. Arjun, one of the questions that we're receiving is about the possibility to integrate optimizers in the future, in the module itself. If you could just tell us about it.
Yes, we are tied up with a few companies and we are doing some detailed research in our factory. We also, if you have time, you can visit our factory. We made a plant setup with the optimizer, how much energy gain we are getting, what will be the LOCE, level of cost of electricity and all that. We are doing that study in our factory. Shortly, we will release the product with the optimizer inbuilt with the module.
Okay, thanks. Sanjeev is asking us about holding clamps on the shorter sides of the panel.
Okay. Whether is he can it, use holding clamp,
yeah, or whether not. We can make
yes you can use holding clamps on the shorter side of the frame, not a problem. But if you are in wind prone area or or coastal area, we recommend you should go for STAT analysis before taking this call.
Okay, can you just explain what this STAT analysis is? That's another question that we've actually received.
STAT analysis is a structural, I think everyone understand PU-SYST. PU-SYST is a software which we can simulate our energy generation in the field. In the same way, when we are constructing a civil structure or a structural buildings, there's a software called STAD, S-T-A-A-D. STAD, where they will simulate what load it can take, what load modules can take, what load the structure can take. Basically, here the load is wind load, they'll calculate. It's a software, basically it's a software which says how much load the structure can take. It's a simulation software.
Okay.
I think...
Yes, another question that we have is about snail trails. How does it happen in very brief, if you could just tell us?
See, snail trail based on the research and technical papers available and our internal research, we saw snail trail is happening because of micro cracks. If your module is having micro cracks and there will be a physical separation, initially it will be no physical separation of the cell, but over a period of time, because of temperature and humidity, cell may physically separate. Once cell is physically separate, and there'll be some moisture ingress from the back sheet to the cell. If moisture ingress from back sheet to the cell, that moisture will eat away all the metallization. That is, we call it as fingers on the cell. It will react with that fingers and it will eat away that fingers. Once the fingers discolorization or disappears, that is nothing called snail trail. That is a snail trail, it is appear like snail trail. Why? Because it is snail trail. Any multi cells or mono cells, if you see, the crack happen like snail trail. It's close to snail trail. That's why it is after installing at the site, once the metallization is eaten away, that metal fingers on the cell, it is appears like snail trail. Coming to our modules and our back sheets, yes, we are having two level of EL check in our factory. So we check EL before the lamination and we check EL after the lamination. So the possibilities of dispatching modules with micro cracks is very, very less, first thing. And second thing is our back sheets are certified with 3X IEC. So moisture ingress into our module is very less. So you can rely, there'll be no snail trail for sure. But again, there is some research papers and we also saw in our plant, even though there is snail trail effect on the module, the generation will not be affected. You will not see huge or any impact on the generation for now.
Okay, Mayank, if you can just take the next question. Is there anything that can be done in addition to cleaning regularly, like we have discussed, to increase the output of panels?
Okay, so there is always an optimum angle at which if it suppose we consider as a rooftop installation, people do slots on the structure and try to increase the angle and align with the sun. So I have seen some rooftop structures in which that way it is done. So that is another way, but that has to be done before we do the installation. It cannot be done after installation. All these changes, design in structures, have to be done before the installation. It is like a tracker. It is a tracker which is done manually. So that is one of the way the generation can be increased.
Thanks, Mayank. Another question for you. So we have Vivek asking us if he should be doing anything additionally to prevent and protect his modules during the rains.
Again, I couldn't hear it clearly.
In the monsoons, do we have to do something additional to protect the panels? Because in some areas it rains quite a bit. So Vivek is asking us if he should be doing anything additional to prevent or protect the modules during the rain, or are they already, you know, able to manage these harsh weather conditions?
Okay, so regarding the solar panels is not a problem, but he has to take care, any customer or anybody has to take care of the connections. So wherever there are the connections, there should not be an accumulation of water, so that the contacts, suppose the contact is not okay and or there's a water collection. So from the panel perspective, physically it is not any problem, but from the circuit perspective, some precautions have to be taken off.
Okay, thanks. Thank you so much, Arjun, and thank you so much, Mayank. And thank you very much to all our participants for joining us today. We will be having our next webinar on the coming Monday. In the meanwhile, if you want to see a copy of today's webinar or of the presentation of today's webinar, please visit our website and you can have a look. And like Arjun has mentioned several times today, in case you have a specific item that you want to use for cleaning or you have some specific questions about your installation and the type of dust, etc. around it, please get in touch with us through our sales team, and we'll definitely reach out to you and see how we can sort that out. Once again, thank you everyone for joining us, and have a great evening.
Thank you.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
Thanks to all.